The Bloodstream podcast is made possible by Takeda and is intended for informational, educational, and entertainment purposes only. Please consult with professionals before making healthcare decisions.
Hello, today is May 18th, 2020. My name is Patrick James Lynch.
And I'm Natalie Lynch.
And you are listening to the Bloodstream podcast.
Had silent heart attacks. I literally had had five silent heart attacks. And the surgeon said to me that he had never known anybody to go through that many silent heart attacks without passing away. So I was told I was needed here for some reason.
That voice belongs to Pete Isaacs, a California-based DJ who lives with chronic pain, became a listener of the Pain Podcast, reached out to introduce himself, and voila, now he's on Bloodstream. Pete and I discuss chronic pain and DJing a little later on in our interview segment. Debbie De La Riva and Amy are back with another mental health moment. We've got a new angle on this segment in the COVID era, which Amy and Debbie will tell you about in just a few minutes. And before we get to that, Natalie and I discuss how elective surgeries around the country have been postponed due to COVID. How big a problem is this and what is being done about it? That's coming up here very shortly in the Like segment. But first, happy Bloodstream recording day, Natalie.
Thank you.
What is top of mind for you this morning as we sit down to record?
Well, I wanted to say thank you to so many of our listeners for reaching out last week for our anniversary. It was really, really sweet. There was an outpouring of love, and I felt loved, and it was a great week.
Yeah, it was really sweet. Very, very nice. One of those times where being a part of a community is very clear just by the volume of messages. So thanks for that, and happy anniversary.
Thank you. Happy anniversary to you, too. 3 years.
3 years, which is kind of wild. At this point, we got married. We were engaged for what? A year and a half. And we knew each other a year before that. So at this point, we've been married for longer than we were dating plus engaged.
Oh, I didn't think about that, but that's true.
Yeah, it's kind of interesting. Which is just a way of saying we're getting older fast.
Yeah. And yeah, so 5.5 years all in.
5.5 years all in.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wow.
So far, so good.
Yeah. Not sick of me yet?
No, not sick of me yet?
No.
There was a little hesitation. Oh, boy. All right. Well, we'll deal with that in just a moment. But first, we got to get to the Like segment sponsored by Genentech. As you know, the Challenge Accepted show is their exciting web series hosted by, you guessed it, magician and comedian Justin Willman. How did you know? Challenge Accepted shines a spotlight on members of the Hemophilia A community. No offense, Hemophilia B community. As they work alongside celebrity coaches to overcome their everyday challenges and get outside
of their comfort zones.
I pointed at her. She wasn't ready. The latest episodes of Challenge Accepted Season 1 are on YouTube, and you can find them by going to YouTube and searching the phrase Challenge Accepted Show. You have to use the whole phrase. If you don't use the word show, you're never going to find it. You're going to be very frustrated. You're probably going to email mailbag@bloodstreammedia.com. We're going to have to answer to Genentech. It's a whole thing. So Challenge Accepted Show. You have to use the whole phrase, or you can click the link in the program notes.
Much easier.
Much easier. Just click that link. All right. So today's Like segment subject is elective surgeries and how they've been impacted in the COVID era. We're recording this, we should say, on Thursday, May 14th, around lunchtime on the East Coast. So as things are rapidly changing, just keep in mind as we cite numbers and such, things may have changed by the time you get to hear this. So if any of this is relevant to you, do please Google and make sure you've got the updated information. Natalie, kick us off.
So there were probably 40 articles written in the last 20 hours.
Wow, really?
Yeah, on this.
Wow.
And it's, you know, from hometown small daily papers to, you know, bigger ones. But yeah, so this is starting to happen countrywide.
Apparently.
And it's different in every state and every county, even down to the counties, of whether elective surgeries will or will not be happening. As of yesterday, New York just approved 12 new counties. So now they're at 47 out of 62 counties are allowed to provide elective surgery.
Hmm.
And the criteria for being eligible is based on COVID numbers, obviously, hospital capacity, what the hospital capacity is currently at, and testing, negative testing in that county.
Oh, yeah.
So I don't know the exact, and the articles didn't go into like the minutia of like what exactly the numbers need to be, but I'm sure that's
looked,
yeah, lookupable.
Yeah, it's probably lookupable in your area.
But yeah, so that's, as of today, where New York's at. And interestingly enough, Northwell Hospital, or Northwell Health System in New York, which is a really large health system, is trying to schedule 12,000 non-corona procedures that are now deemed urgent. So they've been...
Wow, 12,000? 12,000.
And so there's clinical teams sitting around and trying to prioritize who gets to go first and what's most urgent. And their definition of... So that's urgent. That's not even like the amount of elective surgeries that have backlogged.
Right.
But those are
the ones with the upgraded status.
Yeah, and this upgraded status, to be classified as urgent, you need a delay of more than 2 to 3 months that could result in long-term negative health implications for the patient.
That's kind of interesting. I mean, part of me wonders if you are getting an elective surgery to begin with, and I know that there's a lot of stuff that falls into that bucket, but how many things that are elective surgeries could you put off for how long until they are, damaging in some long-term and irreversible way? I know that's a very abstract way to think about it, but part of my gut says we can't put many of these things off for that long, because if they're scheduled to begin with, albeit quote-unquote elective, something apparently needs to be addressed, right?
Sure, and I think it's the 2 to 3 month window, like, you know.
Which for some people, they're in that now.
Right,
you know,
or have been in it.
Yeah.
And so hopefully those people get in first. But if you fall in these categories, and we have two people in our life that we care very much about mm-hmm. who were scheduled for elective surgeries before this happened, both hip surgeries,
yeah,
and who have had to go through quarantine in a lot of discomfort and a lot of pain.
And they're both single too, I think, right? Which also says something too. And regardless, you know, for people who don't have that support system at home as well. So now your surgery is delayed, you're stuck at home, you're in pain, maybe you're by yourself. Like, what a terrible set of circumstances.
Yeah, it's tough. So, you know, what are things to think about if you fall in this bucket? Every state, city, and county are opening differently. So look at where... You know, and maybe if your county and state are not opening and you are in immense pain and the county next to you, it might be changing providers if it's possible to to do so.
True. Yeah.
And, you know, just talking to your doctor, when are you starting up elective surgeries? Where do I fall in the priority? And then finding out what the procedure at the hospital is. Are they testing for COVID pre-op?
Mm.
And what... I've seen in many different of the articles is some are, some aren't. And even in the same county, some hospital systems are and some aren't. And you'd be like, why wouldn't they be testing? And I guess the answer is that if you do the test that, the longer test that requires a few days for testing, that you may then in those few days come across COVID. So you may test negative, but really be positive. Or if they do the rapid test, that those tests are showing so many unacceptable numbers of false negatives.
Right.
So...
My mom's hospital isn't testing, right? Isn't that what you said? Or has that changed?
I don't know. I don't think I've talked to her about that specifically.
Because I know at least they weren't at a time where your mom's hospital in Ohio was. And this, we're talking about a hospital in the hotbed of Flushing, Queens, and they were not. So just to your point about every hospital is different and it might not be the same, even within the same county... that's a very important point to make sure, especially if you're a person of a certain age or a health condition, to state the obvious, and you need an elective surgery. I would imagine the whether or not they're testing for COVID at that hospital is a more paramount consideration for that kind of person.
Yeah, definitely. So, you know, finding out what the procedure is and do you feel comfortable with it, with your current situation, the level of pain you're in for... the thing that you were getting the elective surgery for.
Yeah.
And also, yeah, if you're immunocompromised in any other ways, it's really just weighing the benefits and risks of getting, like, thinking of your whole life.
Well, and to that point too, it's not just the surgery, right? Because after surgery, most people, you have some kind of rehab. Maybe you need some kind of support in the house to help you with your rehab or whatever your circumstances are. So it's not even just that day of surgery, but it's, do you have what you need for that follow-through care as well?
Yeah. And I think, you know, one of the articles that was based out here in LA was saying that there's just a lot of fear, too, still. And rightly so, you know, like COVID didn't go anywhere. It still exists. It's still there. You know, we've just helped flatten the curve a little bit. So, you know, really managing fear in terms of feeling okay to go out in the world. And like you said, that after the surgery, what's the rehab look like? Are you going to need support in your house? Do you feel comfortable having support in your house? Considering all those things.
Did you talk at all about insurance plans or how insurance companies are being, you know, because I imagine with surgeries as well, there are people who had prior authorizations and there was coding in place and then there was a sunset on that. Yeah, so I'm sure there's all kinds of logistical nightmare things on the insurance side.
None of the articles I came across talked about that, but that is an interesting point. I didn't read anything about that. But yeah, it's just interesting with a kind of a 2-month halt on everything that there is a 2-month backlog.
Of course.
And then there are people who are scheduled for now.
And there are people who have fallen down their stairs yesterday and, you know, they now need to get something done. So it's, it's one of those downstream impacts on the healthcare system of the virus. So when we hear talk of there's what the virus is doing, people getting sick, people are dying with the virus. But then there's also the ways it's taxing the hospitals, it's taxing all of the healthcare workers, it's not enabling people to get surgeries they need, it's preventing people from going to the hospital because they're too afraid and then they're getting sick and or worse at home. So this is a very, very big example of those downstream effects.
Yeah, definitely. I was going to say there's this interesting acronym that's used in labor that I think kind of applies to this.
Okay.
You know, when you're considering what to do and making healthcare
choices. About the baby in
choices.
My body?
About the baby in your body, Patrick.
Mm-hmm.
But it's bring your brain. So benefits, what are the benefits of doing this procedure? And then, so that's B. R, risks, what are the risks involved of this procedure or of doing it during this time today?
Is this like a 14-word acronym, bring your brain, B-R-I-N-G?
Brain is the acronym.
Oh, okay.
And so it's make sure you bring your brain.
I was like, we're going to go through a lot of letters.
Use your brain, bring your brain.
Got it, okay.
Oh, yeah, because bring, B-R. No, we just have brain. So B, benefits, R, risks, A, alternatives. What are the alternatives? Is there something you can do to manage your pain for the next 4 or 5 months, be it acupuncture, be it stretching, be it massage, non-usage.
Changing sleeping patterns, whatever it may be.
Non-inflammatory foods.
Mm-hmm.
So B, R, A, and then I is intuition. What is your gut feeling? What is this? Does this procedure make sense to you to do right now? And then N is nothing. What happens if we did nothing right now and waited a while?
Mm.
So B, benefits, R, risks, A, alternatives, I, intuition, and N, nothing. And I think those are really good things. You know, we use them in labor, but also to just consider when you're running a health decision through.
Yeah, of course. I want to talk to you about the labor piece in just a moment. But is there anything else about this topic that you came across that'd be worth mentioning before we wrap the like segment?
No, I mean, it's just that it's happening everywhere and it's happening at different cadences and in different, everyone's handling it a little bit differently. So, but it's starting to happen and that's the news, I guess.
And maybe also like if you know of a relative who had something or struggles with something or this might be on their mind, it might be a good thing to check in. Like I'm thinking this doesn't affect me directly, right? But if mom had her knee surgery scheduled, then this would be on her mind and maybe it would be good for me to check in with her and see like maybe she's having feelings about this and fears or...
Or needs to talk through the brain.
Well said, Natalie. And with that, that will conclude the like segment for this month. And we do want to thank Genentech for sponsoring it once again. And don't forget to check out the newest episode of Challenge Accepted
Show.
Got to use all three words on YouTube. And thanks again, Genentech. I did mention wanting to talk to you about labor, though, because so much of the world has gone virtual. I'm not breaking news here. In fact, since the last time you and I sat down to do this, the National Hemophilia Foundation's Bleeding Disorders Conference was made virtual, so it will now be August 1 through 8 virtual, which, by the way, listeners, Teen Impact Awards, the Science Fair, and Believe's new mental health documentary, Let's Talk, will all still be taking place at the virtual BDC. It will just be virtual. More on that to come. But I wanted to talk with you, Natalie, about your mother's circle and how that, where that came from. And maybe we could just spend 2 minutes. There's a lot of moms who listen to this, plenty of people who appreciate what community support means. So maybe you could share a little bit about what Mother's Circle is and where people can go to learn more.
Sure. So I started with a colleague of mine, a virtual online mother's circle about 2 months ago when quarantine hit. And yeah, people were feeling isolation and the weight of parenting and the weight of being pregnant. So we made it kind of all inclusive. If you identify as a mother, whether you're a stepmother, whether you're pregnant, whether you have 9 kids and they're teenagers, like, if you identify as a mother, this is a circle where you can come.
From anywhere in the world, too.
From anywhere in the world. We've had people in Asia call in, which has been cool. And it's just, it's a little support circle, and it's a check-in, and we do, I teach a different mindful activity each time, breathing activity, alternate nostril breathing. So there's like a little skill learned, and then just the opportunity to share, the opportunity to just listen if you want, and just feel connected to other other mothers.
Nice. So how many have you done so far?
We have our fourth one coming up on the 20th, and it's 1 p.m. Pacific time.
This Wednesday?
This Wednesday.
Okay.
Yeah. So in a couple of days.
Cool.
In 2 days, but you can feel free to sign up at any point. And we also get it. Like, it's motherhood is
unpredictable.
Some people sign up and can't make it.
Sure.
And that's okay too. So
and you've done a nice job following up with people too, even if they signed up and couldn't be there, sending them a follow up email that's just about like, hey, here's what went on in case you want
the
resources.
Kind of the program notes of
of the Mother's Circle.
Of the Mother's Circle, just with links and things that were talked about. And what's cool is going around is the moms often share, their things that are working for them. So then, my partner Tiffany and I take notes, and then we put links so that, sometimes you hear like, oh, this woman said this thing, but I don't even know where to go for it. So then we just send out an email, whether you were there or not, that just says like, hey, this is the thing that was talked about.
That's great.
Yeah. And we're building a really sweet community. If you want to learn more about it, Birth with Intention, Instagram handle, we have all the information on there. Or feel free to email here, and I'm happy to send you the Eventbrite link. Also, if you Google or if you look up Mother's Circle on Eventbrite, it should take you to the page to register.
Okay, so Mother's Circle on Eventbrite, people can check out Birth with Intention's social media handles. There's a website for Birth with Intention too, with the social media handles that you can click through. Or if you want to email mailbag@bloodstreammedia.com, just make sure to put in the subject Mother's Circle so that it goes to Natalie and not to me, and I go, "What is this?" and put it in my trash. So just make sure it says Mother Circle so it goes to Natalie. And thanks. That's really cool. It's a great thing that you're doing.
Yeah, thank you.
Also, did you know that the Bloodstream podcast is made possible by our presenting sponsor, Takeda?
I did know that.
Oh, you probably did. Yeah, we've been doing this for about 3 years. and you can learn more about Takeda, the resources that they have made available for the bleeding disorders community, and what they are doing in response to COVID. You can learn about all of that and more at bleedingdisorders.com. I think you can remember that one, bleedingdisorders.com. And as always, thank you, Takeda. With that, I want to throw it over to Amy and Debbie with this month's moment for mental health.
Welcome to A Moment for Mental Health, our monthly conversation that breaks down stigma and provides a safe space about things that matter. Our goal in this segment is to break mental, emotional, and behavioral health down into its various pieces, and in each episode, focus on just one or two of those pieces. As always, I'm joined by Bloodstream contributor Debbie De La Riva, who is a licensed professional counselor with Mental Health Matters 2. She's based out of Houston, Texas. She is quarantined in Houston, Texas. Debbie, as always, thanks for joining us today.
It's nice to hear your voice again.
Absolutely. Here we are in this time, in this unprecedented time. Today's podcast really focuses on chronic pain. We have a new podcast series that is specifically designed and created and developed for folks living with chronic pain. And today on our mental health segment, we wanted to dive into what how do we handle the stress of pain emotionally, physical pain? What are some of the tools that we can use emotionally and kind of in our internal world? So I wanted to, you know, kind of begin, we're under such unusual pressure and stress here during the pandemic. And so I just wanted to ask you, what is the connection between chronic pain and stress?
You know, before I get started, Amy, I just want to say I'm really impressed with our community, you know, how we've been able to respond to this and so quickly. I mean, NHF and HFA have just pumping out information on mental health and how to cope. And it's one of those silver lining parts of this, you know?
I think so, too. I have been so impressed with them as well, just to state it.
Mm-hmm. So I'm hoping one of the implications of this, or one of the effects of this, is that we work to destigmatize this and talk openly and see what happens when we talk about this, just like our bleed. So pretty neat stuff. But yeah, you asked me about brain and stress. And I'll just kind of scale it down because we don't have a lot of time in this podcast. But basically, you know, our brain has two functions. Well, it has lots of things for functions, but it has two jobs related to stress. It is there to recognize what those threats are and what those challenges are. And then basically, it is there to signal the body to ready itself up so it can respond to the threat. Most people think of this as a fight or flight response. So that's the job of the brain. And this works great, Amy, with, you know, when our threats were that saber-toothed tiger or some other physical thing that we needed to run away from. But as you and I know, most stressors these days are emotional. How to get through this pandemic, for example. And so what's left, Amy, is that our body has all of this energy that's just circulating in our brain, I mean, in our bodies, and it has nowhere to go, and it just wreaks havoc. And I always think of this cartoon I saw. It's not a cartoon that's funny, but it's a cartoon of this IV. Someone's hooked up to this IV drip pole, and inside the fluid, it's cortisol and adrenaline. And, you know, I just really see that that's how I know I've gotten sabotaged and feel like I have this constant drip of anxiety. Had you heard about that before, that fight or flight response?
I have, just recently, actually, when I've started to dig a little bit into just some of the, I don't know, foundational aspects of what anxiety actually is, just because I think I've experienced it my entire life, but it's just become very apparent to me that that's what it is. It's just felt like I get sick to my stomach for years of my life. And just realizing how my thoughts are connected to that feeling and there's no rhyme or reason. I've struggled with a pressure that I've put on myself to try to put words to that place, and it feels unmanageable or something that just doesn't have a name until I calm down, it's like added to the anxiety.
Mm-hmm. Well, I know exactly what you mean, that unrest, and in terms of digestive problems, we do know that because you know your body is becoming ready to fight or flight, all of the parts of our body that are not necessary for that function, like our stomachs, for example, that's why we have a lot of digestive problems, because they're not getting what they need in order to, respond to stress. They're not getting what they need in order to function properly. And so that's where the stomach aches and the nausea happen. But the other thing that happens when our brains are stressed is this neurological thing that happens. When we get stressed, there's this connection between our fear center and our response center. And over time, if we are under continued or prolonged stress, the fear center and the place that responds actually kind of forms this neurological superhighway between the two of them. And so there's this constant back and forth. And you've heard the term the neurons that fire together, wire together. It's that kind of thing. And the problem with this is that over time, too, that connection of our brain that tells us, the frontal lobe that tells us, that has I'm sorry, the part of the brain, the frontal lobe, that actually does the thought processing and problem solving and logic, that connection actually becomes weakened. And that's why we stay, that's why our coping skills are affected, because we can't think properly about things. So I wanted to add that part of it too.
Can you define stress a little bit more? I think I have grown up, and I think this is just like the product of my upbringing. Stress was defined to me, and how I have always understood stress, as being like overworked. It seems like a mundane type of thing. And the older that I've gotten, I've realized that stress comes from many different angles. And so can you define stress a little bit?
Stress really is as a result of a stressor, right? And stressors are just challenges in our life. It can be anything from wanting to get through college or get to that job interview. A stressor is something that is challenging our system, that for us to perform, for us to glide through. So if you think about stressors as challenges, and stress is just a result of us trying to meet this challenge and all the anxiety we have about not being able to, that's really what stress is. It's just a challenge that our body perceives for us to either overcome or run away from, or another part of it is we freeze. We become paralyzed by the stressor we're looking at. So that's where you get the thing about if you're just stressed out, you're just being weak-minded. But it's just not true. Everybody has a natural capacity to deal with stressors, and we have a certain level where we can deal with it effectively. And then if you just throw, it's like throwing, you know, gasoline on a fire. The stressors are just too much for our ability to cope at that moment in time.
Oh my gosh, that is incredibly helpful to me personally. Listeners, I hope it is to you, but for me, that was so helpful. So something that's exciting, we're here at Bloodstream Media, we are collaborating with Mental Health Matters too to put on a Facebook Live coming up this Friday that dives into these topics a little bit more. But you have, you've actually been going around the country in quarantine giving webinars about this very topic and expanding on it a little bit more and actually having it be more interactive. And I, you know, for our listeners to kind of prep for what Friday would be, if you're interested in this, if you'd like to dive a little bit deeper into some of these ideas and topics, tell us a little bit about what you've been doing with chapters. What are some of the tools and resources that you've put together for the community, and what we can expect on Friday when you have a Facebook Live with Patrick?
Oh, definitely. Number one, I just want to give a shout out to, again, our community, because we're responding to this, and we're distributing information to help us. We're doing what we'd always do. There's a need in our community to cope, and so we're just putting out the tools on how to do so and getting informed and getting powerful again. So I want to give a shout out to HFA because they sponsored this webinar, to the Minnesota Dakota chapters, to the Capital Area, Southern California, Nehaw and Maryland. I've done those presentations. Also, of course, the New York chapter and Maryland. And I'm going to be talking to Northern California and FAM Ohio. But basically, what I did is I came up with this webinar about how I came up with this webinar as a sense of two things. Number one, I needed a sense of purpose, to be honest with you, Amy. That's part of my coping, is to get productive and see what I can do about it. But the other thing is that just my professional expertise and my personal knowledge, I know there are things that we can do, that we're not helpless to the pandemic, to let it just run free with anxiety through our body. So I came up with these, basically, these tips to hack that system that I just talked to you about, the stress response system. If we can convince our minds and our bodies that we are actually safe and okay in this present moment of time, we can actually reduce a lot of those free radical chemicals going through our body. So, like, you know, I talked about the normal things like meditation and exercise. But what I also talk about are things like self-compassion, about not beating ourselves up while we're being stressed. And that can be very healing for a lot of people. And I also talk about compound stress. I know personally that this pandemic brought up for me the traumas that I was feeling, or the anxious feelings I was having about having a child with hemophilia. It was the same thing. Mother Nature was more powerful for me and causing my son to bleed and to have pain. And so what I developed as I knew that I needed to figure out what tools I needed to put in my own emotional backpack to deal with that helplessness and that hopelessness that, you know, that I was having for a while. So basically these webinars are just to do what I just did, explain about stress in the brain and how we can hack the system. But the thing about Facebook Live, and that is what you guys do best at Bloodstream Media, is that you take it a step farther. And this idea of chronic stress and how it exacerbates chronic pain is very innovative, and I appreciate that. I was telling you the other day, Amy, that it's so ironic because the gentleman that's involved with developing something called mind-based stress reduction, how we use our brain to reduce the amount of perceived pain that we have, he started with chronic pain patients back in the 80s. And so I'm pretty sure that's what Patrick and I are going to dive more into. And I'm very, very excited about it.
That's terrific. Listeners, please tune in on Friday. I'm getting the actual date right now. How terrible. On the 22nd, May 22nd, for Debbie De La Riva to join us here at Bloodstream Media on Facebook to dive more into this topic about chronic pain and stress and how it affects you in this unprecedented time and beyond, really. Debbie, as always, thank you so much for joining us, and can't wait for our next conversation.
Absolutely. Same here. Be safe.
Thank you, Debbie and Amy, for that moment for mental health. And if you're interested to learn more, visit Mental Health Matters 2, Debbie's organization, where there are many more resources for you to explore. I also want to shout out Amy's podcast, the Ask the Expert podcast. I didn't get all my T's out there. The podcast. She just recently had a two-part interview with HFA's new CEO, Sharon Myers. And this month, next week, she has interviews with NHF's new CEO, Len Valentino. So some really great, I mean, if you're a bleeding disorders community person, you have the two new leaders doing two-part interviews with Amy, both on their professional work and personally who they are and what drives them. So if you're listening to this, I can only imagine that you will definitely want to listen to Ask the Expert this month. We also on Friday had Trevor Martin, the singer-songwriter from our community with Hemophilia A, who has a new single out called Go To, and he came on Bloodstream Live to talk about his music and perform Go To on Friday. The video is on the Bloodstream Media Facebook page, and we will be releasing that audio as a podcast episode, a Bloodstream Mini, coming out this Thursday. And lastly, the Pain Podcast. We're going to talk to Pete Isaacs in just a few minutes, a listener of the Pain Podcast who reached out and yada, yada, yada. Now you're going to hear from him. But I also wanted to mention that we have episode 5 out now, the second to last episode, which takes a close look at how race and gender bias play a role in preventing people from adequately addressing their pain. And in the final episode of the season, episode 6, we take a look at kids and how do we talk to kids about their pain? How do we help them understand and communicate about their pain? That's over on the Pain Pod. And the Pain Podcast has been made possible by Tremo Pharmaceuticals, who's also partially responsible for this episode of Bloodstream. And pain does affect us all. For those of us living with chronic conditions, pain can have an even more prominent role. That's why I'm very proud to share with you the Pain Podcast. Dedicated to exploring pain from every angle, the Pain Podcast provides expert knowledge, innovative strategies, and firsthand stories from people on the front lines of the pain epidemic. Opioids, cannabis, chiropractic, surgery, psychodynamic therapy, systemic racism, Western medicine, the healthcare system, and gender bias are just some of the topics explored in the first season of this documentary-style audio experience. The Pain Podcast is produced by Bloodstream Media and sponsored by Tremo Pharmaceuticals. Tremo is currently investigating two COX-2 selective NSAIDs. NSAID, if you're not familiar, stands for non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. And while neither of them are FDA approved, they are in clinical trials, and you can learn more about those trials, Tremo's mission, and the dedicated team leading it by going to TremoRx.com. That's TremeaRx.com. And don't forget to subscribe to the Pain Podcast from Bloodstream Media. Just before we get to Pete, I actually want to give you a little bit of a tease from the Pain Podcast. We've got a short segment here, and when you're done listening to it, I hope you'll go over and subscribe to the Pain Podcast, but also listen to the interview with Pete and the rest of this, because we got some more good stuff coming here, too. Today's interview is with a fella named Pete Isaacs. Pete emailed us over here at bloodstreammailbag@bloodstreammedia.com a couple of weeks ago. The subject line, the Pain Podcast. The ask was simply to connect with those producing the show. We connected with Pete and learned that, as someone who lives with chronic pain and is passionate about understanding pain, as you're about to learn, we learned that the Pain Podcast had really struck a chord with Pete. In fact, it derailed his own ambitions to start a podcast devoted to chronic pain. Sorry about that, Pete. A DJ originally from Sheffield, England, I invited Pete to meet us on a Zoom call to hear more about his experience with pain and what the Pain Podcast has meant to him. Please enjoy this conversation with Pete Isaacs.
Thank you for what you're doing, man. Thank you. It means a lot. I hope this gets out to as many people with chronic pain, acute pain, as possible. Because I've been, and I'll tell you this, I've been listening for podcasts for years. And there is nothing that I thought was going to make it. And they all failed. And I know yours is going to be successful because you're doing it right from the beginning. You had a guest, Dr. Daniel Lyman, and he knows of me. He knows my wife more. My wife spent Thanksgiving with him 2 years ago, I think it was. And I haven't got into conversation with him. It's been at the same parties that Brittany's had. And I never knew he was a doctor. So when I heard this, I thought it was absolutely fantastic. Like I said, I've met him two or three times. When I started listening, I was so hooked on everything that you were saying. I loved your story about your bike, and I'm very, very sorry for what you go through. And I think people can learn a lot about pain from you, the way you're doing it. And let me tell you why. The reason for this is a lot of the other people have not been through pain. And you make it very clear at the beginning that most of you and your staff have been through pain. So you have the first experience of it. And that shines through, definitely. I mean, if you've walked in somebody's shoes before with acute pain, with chronic pain, it certainly helps how you produce this.
Well, thank you very much. I'd love for you to share just a little bit of your experience with pain.
My pain journey really started back in 2010, so later. At the time, I was 51 years old. I know I'm 61 now. I know I don't look it or act it. And I started with excruciating pain through my arm, top of my back and through my arm. And month by month and week by week, it gradually got worse. I was able to see a doctor, and I was told that due to my hemochromatosis, I was started with a really bad osteoarthritis, which is definitely a symptom. My shoulder was in really bad shape, with hardly any cartilage left on the joint, and I was rubbing bone on bone. It was so painful. The surgeon got me into a full shoulder replacement. We talked about different ways, and in May of 2012, I had my first surgery of a full shoulder replacement. Like anyone, it was a very tough recovery. Not even at the end of my recovery, there was shoulder pain still after it. I didn't understand why I wasn't getting any better from it. And then I found out that there was more problems. The osteoarthritis was in my neck, and they had to do a surgery on my neck. Which was an anterior, they went through the front. It was an anterior fusion with fixation. So that was like C2 to C6. And the pain was terrible. So literally like a year later, I had that surgery done. So I had the shoulder, then the neck, and then I had a couple of years. And Patrick, it never went away. The pain was so bad. And the surgeon told me that probably I'm going to have tune-ups at that stage for the rest of my life. More surgeries for the rest of my life. They found osteoarthritis throughout my spine. And then next, they found that the cartilage was worn very bad on my knees. And they suggested that I had total knee replacements. And hemochromatosis attacks the soft tissue, so your organs, mainly the heart, the pancreas.
Is it inherited?
Inherited. Hereditary okay. Hemochromatosis. And I got a gene from both my parents. I had a genealogy test, and I got it from both. They said to me in 2000 and now we're moving on to 2014, and I had to have a double knee replacement, which is one of the most painful things I ever went through.
And just for a little bit of quick context, so the other surgeries, the neck, shoulder, that was what year or years?
So 2012, 2013, 2014. So at a yearly intervals at the moment.
Got it.
And then I had a bit of a break, and I started feeling still no relief in pain. I mean, the relief from the pain of my shoulder and my neck was better, but now I'm gaining pain in the bottom of my spine. And I went in and they said, your spine's riddled with osteoarthritis and we're needing to do surgery on your lumbar spine. So they had to go in, and this was, I was set up for this 2017. As I was working out, I was getting myself fit for the big recovery on the surgery. Mm. And as I was walking, I felt like a clothesline pain going across my chest, and my right finger was going numb. I didn't think anything of it. It didn't sound any alarm bells or anything. One day I came back, I'd been doing this five times every day for 45 minutes walking. And then I get back and my doctor just happened to call. And she said to me, are you out of breath? I said, yes. So why out of breath? I said, I just went for a 45 minute walk, you know, to try and get fit for my surgery. And she said, you shouldn't be out of breath. Is your wife there? And I said, yes, actually. She said, you've got to go to the emergency department as soon as possible. When I got there, they had a gurney ready for me and everything. Obviously the doctor had called forward and they put me into this gurney. They're setting up everything around me. And we had no idea what was going off. And then suddenly my wife stopped everybody and said, what's happening?
Yeah.
They have found that my troponin levels were very high and I had had silent heart attacks. I literally had had five silent heart attacks. And the surgeon said to me that he had never known anybody to go through that many silent heart attacks without passing away. So I was told that I was needed here for some reason.
I guess so. My goodness. But what a terrifying event, though, to show up. First to be sent to the emergency room, then there's a gurney ready. And, you know, when you mentioned your wife putting the brakes on to just clarify what's going on, like, oof, I just get chills. Like, you must have been so frightened. That sounds terrifying.
I was scared stiff because I, you know, they didn't say anything. And I understand now why they didn't want to put it out there. They didn't want to worry me anymore. And I wasn't really worried. So it was the best thing. They did the best thing because if I did, I could have gone straight into a full-on heart attack. It was craziness, Patrick. It's so difficult. As you said, the pain was so hard to deal with.
So on the other side of that experience, what did you find was different when you came out of that hospital stay? Was there a shift at all in the way that you were experiencing pain, in the way that you were treating or managing, any tools you were using? What changed after that experience?
So, not a lot. Because when I was recovering, I couldn't move. My back was even worse now. So now, they said, we have to give you at least 8 weeks from a quadruple bypass heart surgery to do your spine surgery. So 8 weeks later, now I'm in having the cages and rods put around my spine, around my lumbar spine. And then they said, again, sadly, with the disc degeneration disease and it working its way up the spine, sadly, you're going to have tune-ups. And these tune-ups will probably have these rods extend up the thoracic spine. So that's my life.
It's really quite human to call something as invasive as surgery that involves rods going into the spine as a tune-up, right? We call it a little tune-up, as though you're just bringing the car to the shop. You're not going through surgery, you're going through a tune-up.
That's exactly what we thought. When we walked out of there, my wife and I just looked at each other and go, tune-up? That sounds like major surgery.
The language that we use. So what have you found to be helpful for managing your pain on a day-to-day level?
Exercise is a good one. I have to work through the pain quite a lot.
What does that look like for you, if I could ask? What does working through it look like for you?
I try at this very moment. I'm due for another surgery coming up. And I'm trying to do at least, once again, 45 minutes walk. But once I've even gone down the stairs from my condo and I've gone outside, I haven't even gone 50 feet. And the burning in my thighs, the burning at the bottom of my feet, I think you mentioned it in episode one, we also call it the crickety elbow.
Yeah.
And it feels like pain. Once you get going, it's true. You can work through the pain, but sometimes it doesn't work. And I have to turn back and come back and relax and put heat on it or ice. I have to take my drugs, which I hate doing, but they seem to work. I've been taking opioids, Percocet, since 2012, when all these surgeries started.
And it's been effective for you?
It's been effective for me. Patrick, I have to tell you something. It doesn't take away all the pain. Because most of my pain comes from when there's a trapped nerve, like now in my lower spine, there's a trapped nerve. And when the trapped nerve, it's so painful. So even as strong as Percocet is, it doesn't do the whole job. I still have a pain. So if I'm saying I have a pain that I can't handle, a 10 scale, and it only brings it down to like a 6, with me, it's manageable, but it still hurts.
Right.
I know that you went on to, and this is what I love about your podcast, you went on to some other things in future episodes, I think it was like 2 or 3, where you did bring up people are trying other things. And I do want to mention this to you. I am a person who tried CBD, and all it did for me was it helped me sleep. I did try something that you haven't mentioned yet, but has worked so good for me, and that is kratom. I don't know if you've heard about that.
No, I'm not familiar with kratom.
It's part of the coffee plant, mainly in Asia and Indonesia. And you can buy it anywhere. You can buy it in smoke shops, regular store. And sadly, you have to take quite a bit of it to work. But that has been helping me more.
Huh.
I have to be quiet because my surgeons, of course, they would have to test me for it. And I don't think there's even a test out there. Because I mention it, but I don't care because I know that it's helped so many people with chronic pain. I only take it when I need it. It's like the Percocet. I only take the Percocet when I take it, called chasing the pain. I know to some doctors that's not very good because chasing the pain is not relaxing you so your body can heal. I get it.
Mm.
But when, and you know this yourself, when you get in that kind of pain all the time and you don't know what to do and your mind's just elsewhere, you will do anything to relieve pain. And that's what I was going through. So I tried it. I got some more and it's been helping me immensely.
I mean, what you just described to me sounds like a crisis. And when I'm in a crisis, I'm not in a place to heal. I'm not in a place to shut down. I'm just trying to manage the crisis. So if that means I need to take something I wouldn't take under different circumstances, that's okay. So to the point that you just made, I think when a crisis is what you're facing, it's a different regimen than when it's day-to-day life, which is also, I think, with opioids, where for some people, there's a line that gets crossed because I've heard from plenty of people for whom opioids are an effective tool for them and one of the only ones because of their pain. Okay, great. And so long as that person is using it in the way that suits their pain needs and no more so, then in theory, that should not be a problem. And there are folks who have, of course, been hampered in their access to opioids because of the opioid crisis. So there's also people on the other end of the argument saying all of the opioid epidemic talk and actions, while necessary to a point, they're also preventing me from getting the thing that I really, really need. So it's a complex issue, but it sounds to me that you're doing what I feel as though I'm learning everybody with pain needs to do, which is figuring out what works for you individually, that there really just is not a one-size-fits-all way to deal with pain.
I could not have put it better myself. When you're in a crisis like that, you do reach out to anything. And when I, that's why I still take the Percocet. I understand what people are saying about you should take it regimentally, but I'm dealing with the crisis. And I do believe, I don't mind, I'll open up to you, I'm scared of getting hooked. I've been taking this from 2012. My doctor said I don't take enough to get hooked, but that's not the problem. I mean, you hear nightmare stories of people taking opioids and they're getting hooked. So I'd rather chase the pain and get through the crisis and hope that the surgeries fix my problem, which they have been doing.
When is the next surgery?
So because of these times, I was canceled. It was supposed to be March the 19th. So I just got a call from the surgeon a couple of days ago, and they are putting me back on the list. So I'm hoping for June or July.
Okay.
In the meantime, I just have to deal with it. And of course, even though I'm high up on the list, there's people that got canceled on that are more urgent than I am.
Sure.
And, you know, neurological problems and that sort of thing. So
switching gears a little bit, you know something about entertainment, you know something about audience building, as you've referenced. You're a DJ. When did you become a DJ? Tell me how that ties into the story of Pete Isaacs.
I became a DJ at the age of 18. So 1978, and a neighbor of mine asked me, I was going to college at the time, neighbor came around and said, oh my gosh, the DJ didn't turn up at the Scout Hut. And I went, oh, I'm sorry. He said, would you go up and play some music? I went, I have no idea. I have no idea about that. I can't do that. And I've got my exams coming up. So he pleaded with me. I went up there. I felt terrible. I thought I hadn't performed or helped these kids in any way. Came away, got a phone call. The gentleman, his wife was having a baby. He asked me, please, would I go and do it again the following week? I did it. I started getting this friendship with the kids. And then one of the fathers of these kids came up to me and said, I have a pub down in the middle of Sheffield called the Pig and Whistle. And I went, oh, yes, I know that very well. He said, would you come and DJ? I went, oh, my gosh, bit of a difference from a scout hut. And he said, please, please, yeah, I love your music, that sort of thing. Quickly, I went there. I worked there for a long time. And did the usual Friday night stuff. An agent came in, saw me at that pub, took me all the way around the United Kingdom. I played all the nightclubs around the United Kingdom. And then an even bigger agent saw me in Manchester and took me to Copenhagen, Denmark. I became a nightclub DJ for the Doug Martell agency, worked all over Europe. I would say that was one of my best times of my life. And it was also the worst times of my life.
Why?
The best times, something like, oh my gosh, I've done it to so many people, but Duran Duran. I was one of the first people to introduce Duran Duran on stage at an actual nightclub. And oh my gosh, I mean, I'm very good. Where I stand out is I read people very, very well. And a group of 100 to thousands of people, I can read them. I'll play the right music, that sort of thing. That's where I get my love for music and for DJing at that time. The worst times, because I had 1 month contracts. I was in Europe. The weather, it had the seasons, and in Denmark, it gets very cold. I don't think the temperature gets over 70 degrees. It was extremely cold. So for the most of my, most of the 80s, I was just traveling. It was absolutely fantastic. Then in 1988, I was running into the DJ booth, and I wish I could say I was playing football or something, but I tripped on a 2x4 piece of wood. I went down and I smashed my right knee. Oof. I had to fly back to England and have the surgery, and it was quite a while recouping from that. Now, I was 29 at the time, so the hemochromatosis wasn't showing, which I found was very interesting. But a lot of people still wasn't tested for it back then. And then I got back.
Were you having pain at that time? And sorry to interrupt you, but were you experiencing pain that in hindsight it was probably connected?
Thank you for the question. Yes. Now I know, you know, the aching in my legs because from the standing was absolutely terrible. The feeling like the Cossacks was burning. Now, in later life, I know what that is now, as a symptom of later age hemochromatosis. But then I had no idea what it was. I was young. I just thought, you know, just let it be. But there was a gentleman who came with me. He befriended me out in Denmark, and he had just finished his agricultural studies from Pierce College out in Denmark. And he had some time, and he followed me for a year, and we became friends. He said to me, you'd be great at bar and bat mitzvahs in the United States. And I said, what's a bar and bat mitzvah? And then he said, you've got to come out. You've just got to say, I said, no, the United States, no. drugs and guns and
he said, how much has changed, right?
No, yes. Exactly. So he said, well, you're recovering, come out. So I came out here, Patrick, and I never went back. I got in with a DJ company out here. They started putting me out. They thought it was fantastic. A guy from Sheffield, England with the accent, doing their bar and bat mitzvahs or their weddings. And here's a story for you. One day I was late because of the traffic. I was running and I started putting my equipment up. And who walks in is this guy, and he's got all these suits. And he says, I think I know you. You're the one with the British flag who gets everybody up and dancing around. I said, yeah, yeah. He says, I want to do the same as you. And you know, I haven't been around for a long time. I just got out here from Kansas City. I said, oh, so what are you going to do? He says, well, I want to be an actor. And this guy was dancing with the kids and running around. And at the end, I said, you're going to be a great MC. You were great with those kids. I said, what's your name? He said, Paul Rudd, which I know you know very well. And that's what I did. I mean, of course, I've played for all walks of life out here, and I loved it. And then sadly, 2010 came, and it started wearing very, very badly. I loved DJing. I still love DJing to this very day. I know nearly all the DJs in Los Angeles and a lot of DJs elsewhere. And then standing, the pain started coming. And I've told you before all the surgeries that I went through, but it got worse, Patrick. It accelerated while I was doing lifting, heavy things like speakers and amps and that sort of thing. And it became a real problem. And that's when I started having all the surgeries. So in 2016, sadly, I had to set back from it. I'm still in contact with all the DJs and they call me all the time. I trained quite a few of them. So
how hard was that?
It was so hard. I mean, I loved what I did. I've had the great life, so I cannot complain. I did something that I fell in love with. I did it for so many years. Shy on 40 years of doing it, so I cannot complain. But I miss it so much.
Have you found an outlet or a musical activity of sorts that not fills that gap per se, but has allowed you to put some of that energy somewhere else?
So I touched on this at the top of the show, but I've been thinking about how can I get my story of pain out to people, and surely one person will understand and will learn and will take this and help them through pain, because I just can't handle the pain. So I thought, why aren't these podcasts, why aren't they going on? The pain podcasts, they're losing people, they shut down. There's been so many pain podcasts of one avenue another, and a lot don't make it. And I thought, well, my entertainment background, I'll make it funny, humorous. So I wanted to start a podcast called It's Painfully Funny, have people on, right, with their stories, and try to interject a humorous way. There's nothing funny about pain, but I felt that having the personality I have and keep smiling and laughing and find the funny side has helped me a lot. And I wanted to do that. And then your podcast came along, and it's so well done. I don't know if you know by now the amount of times I've mentioned it, but I'm your number one fan. The pain podcast is absolutely fantastic. It's not what I thought I was going to do, and it's a blog at the moment. So We'll see where it goes. But I've learned off of the podcast too what to do, and they've helped me. So I hope I can do that too.
With maybe I'm conscious of our time, so maybe with our last few minutes, you've mentioned your wife a few times, and notably in particular the time in the emergency room, and you know, my brain hears in that moment, like, there's the advocate, right? Like how important it is to have an advocate as well. What role has she played in your life when it comes to helping you with pain?
She's my rock. She knows me very well, of course, so she knows when I'm putting a face on it. She knows when I need to take some pain relief. She's been there through every surgery. She's an absolute incredible woman. And her pain, she's a Los Angeles Derby doll, first of all. So she gets slammed up to the rail.
Oh, wow. Yeah,
she's
no
broken
kidding.
Fingers. And
that's tough stuff. I didn't realize until I did. Like, I didn't know that, like, roller derby was what it was until I learned. And it's legit.
We would love to take you one day. Yeah, you have to come down and see the girls. They are absolutely fantastic. Of course, I do all the sound for them. But it's listening to those girls, you know, with the pain that they've been through. It's crazy. So Jen is my rock. She's absolutely wondrous. I love her to bits. It's been 21 years. And I keep saying to her, are you going to trade me in for a younger model with a better body? Since all this hemochromatosis started blooming, and she goes, no, I would starve to death because you're the only one who cooks in the house. So.
Oh, there you go. See, you got your value adds. You got your value adds. You can't forget those.
She also helps because she goes into the doctor's appointments with me, and if I haven't explained something properly, she's always there, and the doctors seem, well, they've all got to know her now, but they talk to her too. So because then she knows what the recovery is going to be like.
So Pete, tell people where they can contact you or find your stuff online. Where can people go for more?
You can go to, I just started this blog. So if anybody wants to go to the blog, it's a lot of the blog is about what I'm going through right now. And that is easy. It's painfullyfunny.com. That's the best way.
Everything's funny.com.
Yeah. Yeah. And they should go there because of course I'm going to be mentioning your podcast a lot now. I just wish, if anybody is listening to this, to please educate yourself on your pain.
It's the most important thing you can do. Pete, thank you for talking to me here, and thank you for everything you've said. As you know, as a creative person, it can be daunting and challenging sometimes taking on certain projects, and certain projects of levels of intimacy like this one can weigh heavy at times. But it's for exactly moments like this today where I get to hear how an individual, a human being, has directly benefited as a result of the work that Greg and I and the team have done. It gives me goosebumps because that's the point. That's the whole point. It's for these opportunities to have an impact on one person, and from there, the ripple effect, you just never know. So thank you for listening. Thank you for coming forward and wanting to be supportive. And then thank you for saying yes to coming on to talk to me about your pain, your experience as a listener and as someone who's trying to do more to help others with pain. Just thank you, Pete.
Thank you, my friend. Thank you very, very much indeed. I appreciate it. Thank you.
A pleasure. We'll speak again soon.
Definitely. Take care, my friend.
This month's episode of Bloodstream is brought to you by Takeda.
Hmm.
And we're always grateful for Takeda and their support of the Bloodstream podcast.
True.
And for that, we say thanks, Takeda.
Thanks, Takeda.
If you want to learn more, bleedingdisorders.com is where you can go.
Natalie, it's been another great episode of the Bloodstream podcast with you.
Sure has.
Thanks for the great work.
Thanks.
Reminder to check out the Mother Circle if you're a mother in need of a little bit more support. Reminder to check out Mental Health Matters, too, if you're just a human in need of a little bit more support. And again, NHF's BDC is virtual, as are all of Believe's programs. And if you have any questions, contact us on social media, Bloodstream Media, across the socials, or mailbag at bloodstreammedia.com.
Nobody's going to be sad about not being in August. I mean, being in Atlanta in August.
That's true. We do have people that listen from Georgia. That is also true, though. That is also true. It'll be way cooler inside my air-conditioned office, so I'm not sad about that part at all. And with that, that's all for this episode. Thanks to everyone at Believe Limited and Bloodstream Media, as well as to Pete Isaacs, Debbie De La Riva, Amy Board, and our sponsors Genentech, Tremo Pharmaceuticals, and our presenting sponsor,
Takeda.
Subscribe to the Bloodstream podcast, the Ask the Expert podcast, Bloodstream Journeys. We didn't even talk about that one this time. The Pain podcast, Chico's. Just go to bloodstreammedia.com. They're all there. Subscribe to them all. Apple Podcasts, SoundCloud. You'll find them on all the typical places as well. Leave us ratings. Share the show. Referrals are literally the best way that we can reach new people. Help us spread the word. Again, the email, mailbag at bloodstreammedia.com. If you're like Pete Isaacs and you want to try to get on the show, find Bloodstream on facebook.com/bloodstreammedia and at Bloodstream Info on Instagram and Twitter. The program notes are where you can find all of the relevant links for the stories and moments featured on this episode. My name is Patrick James Lynch.
And I'm Natalie Lynch. And I have a challenge for our listeners.
Go.
Grab your parents' or older relatives' phones and just put the podcast on them.
I like that. Thank you. Do exactly what Natalie said. Thank you. And we'll see you next month.